celebrating for the museum, like a little over 10 years ago. And then we've kind of added to it and show it to all our new members during their orientation so they get a little background of what has gone on here. And for older members, it brings back a lot of memories. So we'll get started. I just wanted to mention that, of course, the corporation here is the Bay Area Electric Railroad Association, doing business as the Western Railway Museum. So your membership card will show that you're a member of the Bay Area Electric Railroad Association. The association was started back in 1946 when this particular Key System streetcar 271 was going to be scrapped. It had served, was built in 1904 and had served during World War II and was pretty much worn out. And a group of rail fans, primarily in the East Bay, decided they'd like to buy it. Do you recall what the cost was, Bill?
It was $200.
Yeah, $200.
They had an excursion, passed the hat, and collected $200 and bought the car.
Of course, the problem with buying cars is where you put them once they're yours. This was taken in about 1948, just before the streetcar service ended in Oakland and Berkeley, and 271 leads the parade. 271 today is down in car house one.
It's actually in the shop right now.
Yeah, it's in the shop.
Oh, is it in the shop now? And I was going to say it's scheduled to be worked on soon and maybe go into a refurbishing program so that it'll look like what it did back then. For years, the club was headed, kind of held together by a secretary who lived in Berkeley. So meetings were held in Berkeley at the Shattuck Hotel, which of course is still there, and where we had a banquet on the 50th anniversary. And right outside the Shattuck Hotel was Key System's F line that went to Berkeley. So it was always fun to anticipate a Bay Area meeting and going there on the train. Those of us that lived in San Francisco to go to the monthly meetings, of course, would always try to take the Key System and get on the F train at the Transbay Terminal, which ceased to exist just in the last year or two. And then cross on the lower deck of the Bay Bridge. Past the key yards. One of the buildings that you see on the right, there were three of them, shop buildings, and one of them is still there when you come off the Bay Bridge going into Oakland. If you look to your right, you'll recognize the roof line of it. And so it's going past a lot of the equipment that was operated by the Key System in the late, up until the late 50s. We take a look at cars such as these that now reside here at the museum.
Chuck just mentioned at the building there, they were going to tear it down, and they found out, you know what the building was built out of? Asbestos. It looks like corrugated metal, but it isn't. It's pressed asbestos.
Where did you move the first car you bought for $200?
The first one was stored on West Grand Avenue. Under the building is still there, and it has a track underneath it. And if you know where to look, you can see the building. And then we stored, in later years, we stored them in West Oakland. West Oakland. That was where the Key System shops were.
Key System was very generous in letting us store a lot of things in their yard. One of the fun things about riding the bridge units was what was known as the rail fan seat. The motorman was in the compartment to the right, and when they loaded in San Francisco, all the rail fans would head up to the seat opposite the motorman and looking out the front window. This is at 40th and San Pablo in Oakland. And this is where the F line turned off to go north to Berkeley. This is an F train on Shattuck Avenue in Berkeley. This is just about where the BART station is today. And then, of course, after the meetings, it was always fun to ride home at night over the bridge and see the whole Bay Area from the train. After we bought the 271, as Bill pointed out, it was stored in Oakland, and the key system would permit us to run excursions with it. And that was about the only way the club could generate any money. And on some of those excursions, you know, we'd make $50 or $60 and put it away for restoring the cars and finding a place to put them. Here's another scene on the B line, Trestle Glen, where a regular service car is passing the excursion car and everybody's out to take a photo. Piedmont Station on the C line. Of course, the main part of the station, the street front of the station, is still there, and there's a big plaque there remembering that this was this key lines, key system station. As I mentioned, we raised most of our money through excursions, and this was an excursion with Shipyard Railway cars, which are now either in the shop or Car House 1.
No, they're on display today outside Car House 3.
Oh.
And the two of them have been completely, outside-wise, have been completely restored to what they look like on the Shipyard Railway. This was a time, though, when the Railway Locomotive Historical Society owned the cars, and they let us charter the car. And eventually they gave them to us because they got the same letter we got, get your streetcars the hell out of here. So they gave them to us.
Became your problem.
Yes. They're the oldest cars we have. They're 1886. And they were built before electricity. They were pulled by the steam engines on the elevator in New York.
They were brought out to Oakland during World War II to provide passenger service to Richmond, to the Richmond shipyards. That's why it was known as the Shipyard Railway. In April of 1958, the key system was finally abandoned. And this was a group of rail fans out taking pictures of the last car to leave on the C line. With the bridge railway shut down and the key system line shut down, there was no need for their big shops in Emeryville. And so they began to dismantle them, and in dismantling them, of course, they were tearing up track, and our cars were sitting on a lot of the track, and we began to get these nicely phrased letters at the beginning.
Get your streetcars out of here.
The shop switcher that we have, and then the 271, and to discourage vandalism, we put corrugated steel all over the windows.
That didn't work too well. The kids broke inside and broke the windows from the inside out.
During that same period, or a little earlier, the Sacramento Northern still operated electric freight into Oakland and had an inspection car that they would let us charter and do trips on the Sacramento Northern. This is on Shafter Avenue in Oakland.
It's the 1019 that was made into a maintenance way car called the 302. And when we got it, it was a bunk car for the railway.
But that too resides in our collection now.
Yes.
And the line went through a tunnel under the Oakland Hills from roughly Montclair over to the Redwood Canyon. And this is a car coming out of the east portal of the tunnel. This area is overgrown now to the point it's almost impossible to see. If you really know where you are, you can stand on this spot, but it's, you'd be in the middle of bushes and trees and all kinds of things. Here's an excursion train using the Sacramento Northern Star and the Salt Lake and Utah parlor car number 751, which will be running today on trains and which run in regular service here by often. One of our members was stationed in Salt Lake City during the war and rode this car several times and bought it and turned it over to the association. As things evolved, the last place that the Sacramento Northern was still electrified was between Marysville and Yuba City and some of the spur tracks in Yuba City. And so the only place that we could charter the car to operate electrically was in that spot. So this is, that's the Western Pacific's Marysville station in the background. And we have trips up there, which was quite a distance. This was a Sacramento Northern Burning car that we acquired. Too could still be run on that.
Did you keep the cars up there or have to transport them up to upgrade?
They had to be transported back and forth. But
a couple of cars were kept up there. The 62 was kept up there and also the Muni's 178 at one time.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Stored up there.
And we did excursions on the Muni in those days. This is one of the last cars to go down to the ferry building, 1016, which we have in our collection and which a couple of years ago was restored, and if you see it now, it looks like it just came out of the factory. Just beautiful restoration done by Dave, one of our members, Dave Buford. And we did fun things like have excursions down the 40 line that went all the way down to San Mateo. This is in Burlingame, and blue and gold car is a regular service car, and our excursion car is over on the left.
That's the number one.
Well, that
and
was the
number one that still operates on our street. And we usually do an excursion around Christmas and out at West Portal, at the old West Portal station, the merchants were decorated up as the world's largest fireplace. In 1962, it was going to be the Muni's 50th birthday, and they asked a representative from all the rail fan clubs to come to a meeting to talk about what could be done to commemorate the occasion. And Bill Kluver was our delegate and pointed out to the group that car number one, Muni's first car, still existed, but was stored on a pier off the Embarcadero and was deteriorating quickly because of being over the water in the sea air. So Muni thought that was a good idea. They got the car, took it to the Geneva car house here, and refurbished it and ran it for a week on Market Street at a 5-cent fare. Bill's been having ideas ever since. Ran between the Transbay Terminal and Van Ness Avenue. The club even went so far as to have excursions down in Los Angeles. In those days, you could get an overnight train on a Friday night, go down and ride the Pacific Electric for Saturday and into Sunday, and then take an overnight train back to be back to work on Monday morning. I think we did about 6 or 8 of these excursions down there, including on the last day of service. This is our charter car that went from Los Angeles to Long Beach and back on their last line that was operating. We went north to Portland on a trip that got a lot of publicity in the Portland press, and excursion with the car with the white flags on it, 4003, which is identical to car 4001, which is being restored right now in our shops. So we'll have a car that can operate that came from originally from Indiana, then Portland, and then Portland. Probably our biggest undertaking is a special train on the Milwaukee Road to ride
Missouri?
Their electrified sections. And that was a, what was it, a week-long trip, Bill?
Yeah, this were, we ran the last electric passenger train on the Milwaukee Railroad.
This is Missoula?
I think so.
I'm not sure.
I'm not that familiar with it.
In the meantime, our cars were stored in Everville, and the system's letters were getting less and less friendly about get your cars out of here. So it became imperative that we do something. So one of our members who was in the real estate business did some searching and found two different pieces of property that might fit our needs. So early in 1960, we had a chartered a bus and viewed both properties. It wasn't this bus, but this bus came along. And you can see the old configuration of the highway, which was right outside the old gas station that had been closed for quite a while. And prior to that, during World War II, it served other purposes and was known to the men at Travis Air Force Base as the hump.
It's kind of interesting, the bus there, it was owned by Bill Billings of the East Shore Bus Lines, and he acquired it from the Shipsteads and Johnsons, used it to charter when they had their ice skating things going on. And then he got hold of it, held on for years, and this was an excursion. It was really a neat bus. It had curtains in it and everything. It ran quite good, didn't have very good brakes though.
Is it still in existence?
I believe it is. Uh-huh. I believe the bus is.
Hopefully the brakes are a little better.
Yes.
Keep it on flat ground.
Well, we bought the property, the 2 acres with the buildings on it, and the 20 acres that we have outside that this building sits on. And the scheme was that we would refurbish the old station master's house and rent that out to help pay the mortgage. And that was good for about 6 months till the county came out to look at what was going on and red tagged the building.
They red tagged every building, saying they were unfit for human habitation.
So that kind of ruined our plans, our financial plan. But several members who were able to dug deep in their pockets, and we kept the mortgage paid and eventually paid them back. But it took a long time. Here's the first car arriving here. That tree is still up at the corner of the property.
No, it was the only tree that was on the property, we killed it. We got this stuff, Norm Borborg bought this stuff called Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. And it was a wonderful herbicide, and you put it around and it killed everything for 5 years. It sterilized the ground. And that poor tree, the stump's still there. It's where the mailboxes are. You know where it is, up there.
And we refurbished the gas station to the point that we could open a little museum store there. And that became a source of revenue. A lot of members are very loyal, and when they wanted to buy a railroad book, they'd come up and buy it at the store and help the cause. And here's one of the first cars that arrived here. And,
that's the Key Systems 987, had gone to Portland. Hmm. We sold it to them. They leased it from us, and then it came back to us after the Portland Traction quit.
And this is what the property looked like when we were up there at the bookstore and looked south or east. It was pretty bleak.
There was nothing there.
One Sunday we were working up there, up here, And the highway patrolman stopped by and said, "Oh, what are you guys doing?" He said, "Oh, we're building a railroad museum." Oh. So he passed the word on to the county, and the county was out the next day with a putting red tags on everything and saying, "You can't have a scrap yard here. This is not zoned for scrapping cars." So one of our members who worked in Marin County as a county planner came over and talked to the officials and knew all the right phrases and things to say. And they took the red tags off and said, "Well, I guess you are a museum, but you know."
What county are you in here?
Solano.
Solano.
Yeah. This was a kind of a thing we had. We got a flagpole, and the flagpole was in one of our friends' place down in Burlingame, and we got it up here, and we originally had a toilet float from a toilet for the top. We painted it gold and put it on top. So then I was going around the junkyard, and I found that ball. And I said, "Gee, we ought to get that on top of the flagpole." Well, it turned out it had a huge brass truck underneath it, and it would weigh a ton. And that's trying to get the flagpole up with the ball on it. And so I said, "Oh, we'll get a new flagpole that will fit the ball." So I went around looking for a flagpole. And the guy says, "How big do you want this?" And I said, "Oh, it has to be about 8 or 9 inches on the top of the pole to fit this thing." "What's it for?" I said, "A railroad museum." He said, "Oh, I like trains." So he came up here, and we showed him that thing. And he looked and said, "Where did you get it?" I said, "I got it in a junkyard." He says, "My father made those. Those were for Nike sites." And he said, "If you get it down without breaking it, I'll give you a new flagpole and the right ball and everything." And he said, "But don't break it." So this is getting it down here. We had, if you could take a look, we had a bed spring out there in case the thing fell. And so we got it, and so just recently that flown on the Fox Plaza in San Francisco.
Notice there are no hard hats or gloves in the picture.
So anyway, it was kind of interesting. The whole ball cost $5, and that flagpole that we got now is flying outside the door here. The one that he gave us, it was Bolander and Sons.
We named ourselves the California Railway Museum, and that went along famously until the state built their state railroad museum, and there was a lot of confusion between the names. So we threatened to sue the state, claiming that our name was here first, and they should change their name to something else. But as you might guess, we lost. Well, over the months and the years, more and more cars kept arriving up here. Some came up on their own wheels in freight trains. There was still weekly freight service on the Sacramento Northern out here. So some of the bigger cars, like 1005, could come up on their own wheels, and some of the smaller cars, like that little Bernie car, first in line in the rear, came by truck. So it was one of the things we realized then was every time a car arrived, you needed more track. So it was a constant battle to get enough track to accept the next car that was coming up here. This is still the track that we operate on, same alignment, which was engineered by some of our members. There's 271 again, the one that started it all. And here's some track laying. As I say, we weren't too aware of OSHA, if it even existed then, but today we'd all have hard hats on and gloves and steel-tipped shoe and all the rest, but in those days we did the best we could with what we had.
This is moving the portable substation in to its place.
And if you needed to move a piece of machinery from one track to another, you gathered everybody that was here, 1-2-3 lift. Here's putting up some of our first poles to pull their wires, and it was done much like the flagpole was. What were these picks called?
Pole planks.
Pole
pikes.
Pikes, whatever. And we'd dig the hole by hand and then put a pole in it and prop it up. Later, one of our members who had bought this crane from the Key System when they abandoned their rail service got to the point where he could set the poles, and that made it much, much easier. And there, people are stringing the wire.
You can see the trees are starting to grow in the park.
Still, everything was done outside in pretty rugged conditions at times. Dang, if you'll bear with me. Anybody have any questions so far?
What year are we up to now?
We're up to the mid-60s, probably 64 or 65.
This is just before Car House 1 was put in, right?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, around the same time we started building Car House 1. Yeah, we built a 300-foot section of it first. It shows here.
And you guys are putting down a new track here by the station, but was there a lot of existing tracks still?
No, nothing here. This was the blank field.
But I mean, kind of north and south of here.
Oh, yeah, the track was all still in, yeah. That's the first section of the Car House we built. It was four tracks wide and 150 feet long.
Basically, it was a hay barn.
A pole barn, yeah.
Put it up on a farmer's property and he stores hay under there. And the contractor said, well, this will be good for about 20 years.
Right.
Well, of course, it's going on to 60 years now and is badly in need of replacement. But it sure lasted a lot longer than we anticipated.
Then we extended it.
One of the harshest things up here on the cars is the summer sun. Of course, the rain doesn't help them either, but the sun does an awful lot of damage. We were still able to operate some excursions, and what we would do was lease a Sacramento Northern diesel engine and either use our cars or cars that we would borrow from the Southern Pacific or whoever, and do trips around the area. In this case, the locomotive is hauling two of the three key units that we have. And we're stopping for photographs all along the way. And this is in Vacaville. Sacramento Northern had a branch that went to Vacaville to the onion dehydration plant. They hauled it out. Dehydrated onions. And this has been abandoned now. There's no longer tracks into the back. One of the biggest undertakings we had for about 3 years in a row was chartering a train first from Southern Pacific and then the last time from Amtrak and bringing up, making a whole day of it by leaving Oakland on the SP train, going around through Stockton and Sacramento and then coming in here to the museum and then going back the short way through Martinez. So it was very popular, and I think the longest train is probably this one. It was 22 cars.
Frontier was the largest passenger train ever on the SM.
And on those days and on other days, we have trolley festivals, we call them. And people would picnic in the park, which is now covered with trees, but then it's pretty open, and run every tar that we had that was operable past them. And this gentleman here, Bill Kluver, we have a sound system set up, and he described and talk about each car as it went by. And those were very popular days. A lot of people came to those. On one occasion, the parade of cars was led on by the Coast Guard band from Alameda. And that was a lot of fun to watch that. There's the pieces, first key unit that we repainted into the original 1937 colors, which had been done by an artist who was also a member here. Of course, not, he wasn't a member in 1937. And we gave rides on things that our insurance company today would shudder at. Gave people a lot of rides and a lot of fun. We were still able to operate the number
94,
which was Western Pacific's engine that hauled the first train into Oakland on the Western Pacific. And of course now it's in Car House 3. And we operated it for a couple seasons, but it became so expensive to get the fuel for it. And also as the years would progress, I had a tendency to set fields on fire. And that wasn't very popular with the neighbors. So we got to the point we could only operate it in the winter when things were wet and green. And eventually we just had to give up on operating it and make it a static display. Our fight with the state didn't get us anywhere, so we became the Western Railway Museum. And that ended a lot of the confusion between California Railway Museum and California State Railroad Museum. And here we are building the shop building. This, one of our members found a steel building for sale in San Leandro that could be disassembled and then reassembled up here.
And it was in the way of BART. And they told us we could have the building if we disassembled it. So we took a couple of gondolas and we took the thing down, put it in the gondolas, and shipped it up here.
Yeah. And then the assembly was all done by our members. I don't think we had any outside contractors. Pretty soon we had a shop building that was better than most interurban lines in the country when they were at their prime. About the same time, Muni was rebuilding its, what was then Geneva Car House, or Elkton Shops, into the Muni Metro Center, as we know it today. And we were buying a lot of new equipment for it, and giving us the old equipment. So this is the metalworking side of the shops. And the other side is, not shown here, but it's the woodworking side. So once the shop building got up, it made it so much easier to work on the cars. And we could take a car like this, put it in the shop for a couple months, and have it come out like this. So that was really one of the great assets that we had and have, is our shop building. Here a group are putting on a new roof on the burning car, Sacramento, Northern number 62. And we're doing it by all the old methods of bending the wood under steam and trying to do it just as if it had been done originally. Here's one of our miracle workers, Don McKenzie, who still volunteers up here, usually comes up on Wednesdays when volunteers assemble here for a day of work. And he's very good at woodwork and very good at metalwork. He can look at a part, go over to the lathe, and pretty soon you have a second part. Very talented. This is the Petaluma and Santa Rosa car that everybody gets a laugh out of reading the messages on the side of the car. Ship electrically, ride the cars, keep the railroad going. And we found this is a mountain cabin. Where was it at, Bill?
By Lake Berryessa.
Oh, Lake Berryessa. Yeah. And
It was built by the Holman Car Company in San Francisco, so it was built out of local woods. Unfortunately, it's kind of a cheesy car. They never used many hard woods, but the car is really quite classic. And the lettering and the siding was all what they tried to promote the people to take. It said, you know, avoid parking problems, avoid blowouts, take the electric car, things like that.
This ran from Petaluma up to
Sebastopol and Santa Rosa.
And spur over to Santa Rosa and then further north to Forestville. Not quite to the Russian River, but pretty close. The car on the left, car 111, came from what rail fans call the Crandon, Cedar Rapids and Iowa City Railway. And it's probably the fastest car that we have on the property. It'll probably do 70, 75 miles an hour.
Well, it had a balancing speed when they had, what do they call them, things that could short the motors on it, but it had a speed of 97 miles an hour.
Yeah, this
is a picture of a racing an airplane.
It wasn't particularly this car, but one just like it. It was in that famous newsreel where the airplane and the interurban car had a race, and the trolley won.
Back in the CNLE days?
Yeah, that was back in Indiana. But it's a real gem. It's an awful lot of fun to ride.
It had a nickname. They call it the Vomit Comet.
And the kids going to college in Iowa City.
Bounce all around.
So they would bounce them around so much. As time went on, we got a little more professional, and our crews began wearing railroad uniforms.
And red suspenders.
Ran on schedules and did all kinds of things. This is our Oakland Streetcar 352.
It's there.
And the motorman like standing above the rest of the crowd is Paul Trimble, who has set up a program for school groups here. And he's extremely good with the kids. And was always here whenever a school group was going to come and gave them lectures on safety and history. And the way he did it, they got a big kick out of it. Until just a few years ago, we'd get maybe as many as 30 or 35 school groups in the springtime. And then with all the cutbacks and money for education, now we only get about three or four. Mostly, the schools can't afford the charter bus to bring the kids up here. So some PTA groups and mothers' clubs and other things have bake sales and do all the things they can to raise the money to get the kids up here. And and the kids have a great time. They come up here and ride the trolleys and eat their lunch out in the park. And take another ride or two. And in the meantime, the programs about the history of the interurban cars and that kind of thing. So we have a good time. Our track crew is phenomenal, and it's under the direction of Joel Cox, who is in charge of the tracks between Oakland and Sacramento for the Capitol Corridor. So when we take a look at the old SP line, that they put an awful lot of money in to speed the trains up. He does that 5 days a week. Then for recreation comes up here.
Jesus.
So some of us build some track. But over the years, he's managed to get a lot of mechanical equipment, either secondhand from the railroads or some of it came from the government. And being a nonprofit organization, we can get quite a large discount on government surplus things. And so right now he's got a crew and the machinery that is maybe not quite up to date, but pretty close, and they do a wonderful job.
To give you an idea, a tie today costs $49 delivered here. And you have one every couple of feet. This is our line truck we got used from the PG&E. This is what we drill the holes, set the poles, and it's really quite a gizmo here. It saves a lot of work.
No more hand digging of the holes. And setting them is much, much easier.
Every pole today is worth about $450. A mile worth of trolley wire now is about $20,000.
Do you keep the wire energized when you're not here to discourage copper thieves?
Well, it we've thought of it, and we've been very lucky this way. We've had some copper thefts in the area here, but none of our trolley wire has disappeared. But it's amazing. First of all, it's too high to get to, to really cut it down.
What is it, 22 feet high?
22 feet high. This is what the PUC says you have to have it for running a boxcar or a freight railroad. The Muni doesn't have to have it that high.
Chris Pagney heads up our overhead line department, and here again, they do a very, very professional job.
And this is the old Key System line car here. It was built originally for the California Railroad, which was a railroad that had a big name, ran from High Street, up High Street in Oakland, from the up to a place called Leona Heights, and that was it. And then the Key System bought it out, and they made this particular car, which was originally a railroad coach built by the Carter Brothers Car Company in Newark in 1895. And they built it as for their line car, and we still use it today.
Of course, these days we have a lot of fun operating trains to Pumpkin Patch in October, the last three weekends before Halloween, and pulling trains like this, hauling the people down, and that's become a very popular annual thing. Oops. This is what the interior of the Salt Lake and Utah 751 looks like these days. And people pay a small surcharge to ride in the parlor car, and in return they get lemonade and cookies. Ah, the spring. Everything's green. As all this other progression took place, we decided we really needed a decent visitor center. And one of our members did a lot of research on various Southern Pacific, well, any railroad depots, and found that this seemed to be about the size and shape we needed. And this was modeled after the Southern Pacific station in Atascadero down near San Luis Obispo. And so that's what we had the architects work on, and it came out a little different, but basically the same. And we're very proud of it. We finally opened it in 2001. The wing on the left side is the archives, library and archives, which you're in right now. And the wing on the other side houses the restrooms and the depot cafe at the far end. When plans were made for this, I was already working in the archives here, and asked us to give them an idea of how much room we needed for, it would be sufficient for the next 20 years. So we put our heads together and came up with a figure for the architect, and that's what he built. And we found that within about 4 years, we were short of space. Once the building was up, humidity and temperature controlled and very well organized, and so many members decided this was the place for their collection. And for several years, we were just swamped with donations, which we loved, but boy, we really had to keep working hard to make room for the next donation that was going to come in. So that's kind of eased off somewhat now, and we're doing a second level in archive and eliminating a lot of duplicate and things that aren't really pertinent to our collection. And that's the type of thing that's out on the tables so free for you folks to take if you like. This is our little wave room. Where did the benches come from, Bill?
They're from the SP.
16th Street
Station. Well, yeah, the one's from the 16th Street. The other one's from 3rd and Townsend. And then the bench is out in the snack bar area. That's kind of interesting. It looks like real railroad benches, but they're from the aquarium in Golden Gate Park when they redid it.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize
that. Yeah.
This was our display area a couple of years ago before the traction lab was set up out here, which has proved to be very popular with kids. At one time we had several displays, but nothing moved. Now the kids come in here and can turn the wheels and the propellers go, and they just have a real good time. Our museum store at the far end of the complex out there provides revenue every month to keep our operations going. And our Depot Cafe at the end of the other wing is more of a convenience than a revenue maker, but some months it makes a little bit of money and others it doesn't. Something that everybody seems to enjoy going in to get a hot dog or during the hot afternoon an ice cream or whatever. The man in the plaid shirt, his name is Frank Harvey, and he volunteers every Saturday. So we all kid him that he runs Harvey House, the Harvey House here. And here's the room that we're in. F.M. Smith Memorial Library, Francis Marion Borax Smith. And this was the man that made his money in Death Valley hauling borax with the 40 mule team wagons that Ronald Reagan used to tell us about on television. And once he had made his fortune, he came to Oakland and built a lovely mansion and moved his family here and took a look at the transportation situation. This was about 1900, 1901, and started buying up. Oakland had like 8 or 9 different cable car and streetcar companies, but nothing was consolidated. You had to pay a different fare if you went to a different company, and all that type of thing. So he consolidated the whole thing under the name of the nickname, really, of the Key System, and built the Key Pier, which went out about halfway to Yerba Buena Island, and then ran ferry boats so that people could get to San Francisco much quicker and much cleaner than the Southern Pacific, which was running commute service with steam engines. And they finally came around in 1911 and electrified their lines. We wanted to call it the Borax Smith Memorial Library, but some of their of the family of Mr. Smith had been very generous contributors here. And we consulted one of his granddaughters about what we plan to do, and she said, oh no, don't use the term borax, no. So we just have him soon. There's an archive work party going on. Volunteers meet here every Wednesday, catalog and sort and clean and do whatever needs to be done here in the library. Here in the library, all the books and the videos and the cases can be checked out for a month at a time by members. So that's one of the perks of being a member here.